author and respected professional who is from South Africa, and gave a heart-rendering speech, gave information that many of the people in the audience didn't know. His real thoughts about being a white South African and the years of apartheid, and I just was compelled to interview him, wanted to do it live before he takes off to go home. This is Dr. Graeme Codrington, who is a member of the esteemed International Federation of Professional Speakers. Hello, Graeme. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, take us back to yesterday. I was coming to this country for me was bittersweet. I've never been to South Africa. I have been to Kenya. I have a real love connection with Kenya. My father lived in Africa for 20 years, so I've known Africa since I was a child. But for me, it was a process I needed to go through to come to South Africa because of apartheid. And because as an African American, you know, I have my own experiences and realities about the states. So to hear you yesterday was heart-rendering, as I had said earlier, and an opportunity for me to get to know white South Africans in a different light. So share with us just thoughts about your transformation and the transformation of this, I call it an adolescent country now, because of what has happened and where you're going.
Yeah. Oh, well, thanks for the opportunity. I started my speech yesterday, and I'll start this interview in the same way, that I am an African by birth. My grandparents on my mother's side are fourth generation. Well, I'm a fourth generation African by birth, and on my father's side, second generation. But I am also an African by choice. And I think that as a white African, you have to do both of those. You know, where you're born is an accident of geography and out of your control. Where you choose to place your heart, well, that's your choice. And I am African. And so we were a country divided, and we were a country.
It was a caste system, from what
In a sense, yes.
From what because you know, our whole mentality from an American perspective was you had blacks, you had coloreds, then you had whites. But you are helping to differentiate between the levels of whites and the privileges that were given.
And the levels of black and the level of colored, for those who don't know, is the mixed race, which we would prefer, and they would prefer, to be called colored. So it's not a derogatory term used in South Africa. And of course, there were Indian. There's an important Malay Indian population as well, and a reasonably significant Chinese population. And interestingly, Chinese people have white skins, but were not considered white under apartheid. It was crazy. I mean, we know it was crazy. It was nuts. But as a white South African, I was a child of privilege. And yet, as I grew up, realized that I had not understood the country that I was part of. And so I, although it was the country of my birth, I couldn't really say it was the country of my heart. Because I didn't know it. And coming as an adult, having opportunities, a number of experiences that opened my eyes to other people, something I didn't say in my speech yesterday. As a white person growing up in a nice house that was well looked after, and I just thought that all black people live in squatter camps and the bush. You know, that I suppose the dream in America was the dream that the color of your skin should make no difference to where you're born or where you choose to place your heart. And I claim that dream as in the opposite way, almost, as a white African. I claim that. So that's my starting point. But it isn't a point that I started at in life. Being born in 1970 in South Africa as a white child, I was a child of privilege without knowing it. I came from a reasonably poor home. My father was a school teacher and after that a church pastor, neither of which are really well-paid professions anywhere in the world. But even growing up in what I would have considered a poor home, I was nevertheless in a white home in apartheid South Africa. And that was a home that opened me to a lot of privileges, free education and health care and a really nice house in the suburbs. And the minority, you know, there are only 9% of the country are white English speaking. Again, maybe that's helpful for people to understand outside of South Africa, apartheid wasn't white versus black. because there are different types of whites and there are different types of black, different tribes and different clans. And in fact, we have 11 official languages in South Africa at the moment representing that diversity. And so as an English-speaking white person, it was an interesting
one. Let me just ask you, you said that apartheid was not white versus black. What was apartheid?
Apartheid was a white-dominated government that used, that was mainly controlled by Afrikaans-speaking white people, who excluded and included people in many different ways. Mm-hmm. They were able to get, for instance, one of the big divides in politics at the moment, which is about to be mended in some way, was the divide between the Xhosa tribe, which Nelson Mandela and Thabo Mbeki come from, and the Zulu tribe, which probably our next president, Jacob Zuma, comes from. And that is, with all the other things being said about Jacob Zuma, it is very interesting that he is a Zulu. Because the divide between Xhosa and Zulu is huge.
Really?
Because the many Zulus and an entire political party of the Zulus actually worked for the apartheid government as informers and were given special privileges. White English-speaking South Africans as myself, we had privileges because we were white, but we were excluded from many things because we were not Afrikaans.
Thank you for clarifying that. That's really helpful.
You know,
really,
I mean, and these are things I've only learned as an adult. I mean, I remember just as a simple example. I was in a school marching band, and my school was an English-speaking school, and we were the only English-speaking school to have a marching band. All the Afrikaans-speaking schools around us also had marching bands. And even though when I was in my final year of school, our band was by far the best. Of course, I would say that, but you know, I think even objectively we were. But because the marching bands came under the military structure, they were part, the judges were from the military, and the military was dominated by the Afrikaans speaking people, we came third. You know, now that's a little story, a tiny little thing, it doesn't change anybody's life.
Yeah.
But I remember as a high school student just feeling the injustice. Now, that's nowhere near the injustice of someone who spent 27 years in jail, but that is the problem in South Africa, is you have these tiny stories of injustice that all add up to the big injustice of apartheid. And so we were a country divided, and we were a country...
It was a caste system from what
In a sense, yes.
From what because, you know, our whole mentality from an American perspective was you had blacks, you had coloreds, and you had whites. But you are helping to differentiate between the levels of whites and the privileges that were given.
And the levels of black and the level of colored, for those who don't know, is the mixed race, which we would prefer, and they would prefer to be called colored. So it's not a derogatory term in South Africa.
Right.
And of course, there were Indian. There's an important Malay Indian population as well, and a reasonably significant Chinese population. And interestingly, Chinese people have white skins, but were not considered white under apartheid. It was crazy. I mean, we know it was crazy. Yeah. It was nuts. But as a white South African, I was a child of privilege. And yet, as I grew up, realized that I had not understood the country that I was part of. And so I, although it was the country of my birth, I couldn't really say it was the country of my heart. Because I didn't know it. And coming as an adult, having opportunities, a number of experiences that opened my eyes to other people, something I didn't say in my speech yesterday. As a white person growing up in a nice house that was well looked after, you know, I just thought that all black people live in squatter camps and the bush. And I remember going on a youth camp when I was a young adult, and I went as a leader, and our church was trying to get different groups of people together, and we invited a whole lot of black young people from a nearby church. We thought we were all great and clever, and we were doing a good thing. And I remember, it's a simple story, but it illustrates what I needed to go through. I was sitting on the floor, and this fairly large beetle, you've sort of been in central Cape Town, so you haven't seen some of the big bugs we produce in Africa. And this fairly large, in Kenya, you would have absolutely.
Big ones.
And we have a few of those around the top. And we were out at a rural campsite, and this big bug came across the floor. And it first of all went past a group of white young girls, and they screamed and shrieked, as of course I expected them to do. And then as it walked across the floor, it came close to a group of black young girls. Mm-hmm. And they screamed and shrieked, which, of course, you should expect them. But as I looked at them, I thought, why are they shouting? They're black. Surely they're not afraid of beetles. Mm. It's those. That's the problem, isn't it? And I'm sure, as people in the States have discovered over the years, the big things, you notice them and you see them, and apartheid was evil, of course it was. But you don't realize how much it has infiltrated your own soul.
Yeah.